Good morning and welcome to Modern Leadership Live. I'm your host, Nina Segura. Our vision is to create collaborative conversations to connect our company cultures and our world community. And today I'm joined by Gino Valdez. He's the former COO of Chipmunk and he is a business transformation expert. Welcome, Gino. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, Nina. It's wonderful to see you.
And today I was really wanting you to talk a little bit about what do you think the world needs more now of than ever as it relates to leadership?
I think people need to understand that coaching is the key to leadership, not being a boss. And I've always adhered to that. I think you develop a sense of trust when you're working with someone, you're trying to help someone develop their skill set and you're trying to help them grow, versus just giving them directions and having them run and do whatever it is that you want to do. So I believe the world needs a lot more coaching, which instills more patience in both parties. And I think it's really, really important that people understand that you're going to get a lot more done with someone that trusts you because you're trying to help them than just barking out directions and telling them what to do without getting any feedback.
Yeah, I love it. So the best leaders practice coaching, not just like dumping a bunch of information out or, you know, giving short orders without a lot of information. They have a collaborative conversation.
Agreed. 100%. And I think part of the issue is also shared responsibility, right? You want to be able to make sure that the person you're coaching also does his or her end, right? You've got to be able to have a conversation where they're holding up the end of the bargain. What does that mean? They need to do an awful lot of development on their own. They need to really understand that it's an agreement between a boss and an employee that, hey, I'm going to help you get there. I'm going to help you get to reach your goals, but you also have to participate. And I find that that's a lot easier when someone understands that they're part of the decision-making process and they're improving themselves by listening to podcasts, by reading, by doing a lot more on their own to improve their skill set. So when the opportunity is there, then it's easy to just move the person along.
Got it. What are some paradigms do you think that get in the way? Some old paradigms?
Oh my gosh. The most, I guess, talked about one now is this whole thing with COVID where, you know, people have been working from home for the last year. And I can tell you before that, if someone wasn't in the office, everybody's asking, where's so-and-so? Why aren't they not here? You know, people, I think the paradigm was if you're not in the office, you're not being productive. And that's not the case, as we've seen. There's an incredible amount of tools that are out there to measure efficiency, productivity. So you don't have to be in the office anymore to participate and to work hard. And I find actually that I'm getting more for my money because people are working all hours. They'll put their kids to bed, get back on the computer, wake up early in the morning, send the kids to school, get back on the computer. So I do think that this whole paradigm of if I don't see them, you know, they must not be working is really changed a lot over the last year.
That's fantastic. Do you mind sharing some of the tools you use to make sure that you're measuring outcomes, not necessarily just what you're seeing?
Yeah, I mean, we have an incredible amount of data that we collect as part of our WMS system that talks, you know, productivity wise in terms of the amount of time that they're on a computer, the amount of time that they're on the floor, you know, punching people in and out. We get an incredible amount of data now that I didn't have before. And you can take that data and turn it into productivity type exercises where you talk about, you know, how many hours is it taking us to get a case out? How many hours is it taking us to do certain things? And I do think that it's really important that people understand that you can measure anything now. There's just so many tools out there that you could use where you just literally tell a system what you want and it'll spit out whatever it is that you need. And it's also a really good tool to coach and help people, right? Because you have data. So you can walk with him and show him, hey, look, you know, our goal is to do the following and you're not getting there. And this is the reason why. And so how can I help you get there, right? And that's ultimately what you want. So the adage of, you know, seeing people around versus measuring their performance is really of value to both parties, because then it's easy to help someone along and it's easy to tell them, hey, and show them the data that then they can see if they're performing at the level that they should be performing.
So I heard a couple of things. First of all, to explain to people what WMS is, just in case they don't know.
It's warehouse management systems, and now they're more sophisticated than ever before. So they're all linked to certain productivity tools like KPIs by day.
Just in case, most people know, but
key key performance indicators, right? So that you literally are measuring their effectiveness every day. And in our business, you know, in an e-commerce type of environment, ultimately, our job is done when an order is taken and that box is out the door, right? And so without that box being out the door, you didn't do your job. And the more boxes you get at the door, the more efficient you are and the more cost effective you are, right? So I'm a firm believer in really measuring KPIs by department, by area. And then we sit once a week on Tuesdays and we go through that report card, if you will, with our managers. And then they'll tell us, you know, what's going on. And in this COVID year, for example, you cannot crowd, right? So you can't have as many people in a very specific area to get orders out. You have to space them. So we take those into consideration versus a typical year where you can have 100 employees, 150 employees in a shift and they're next to each other and they're fine. That was cut down to 75 employees. So you can imagine the impact that had on productivity, right? But it is what it is, but we learned a lot and a bunch of folks stepped up.
You know what I also heard you say is that the best leaders take time to figure out, you know, what data do I need the system to tell me, the scorecard to tell me, mm-hmm. so that I can make good decisions and I know, you know, who my best employees are, who my best customers are, and right. I can create the accountability I need to move the organization forward.
Correct. That's exactly right. And we do the same thing with customers. You have customers that follow rules, right? And they'll send orders in when they're supposed to. And all their items are in the warehouse, so it's easy to pull orders. But yeah, without someone playing the game, if you will, then it becomes extremely inefficient. So I think it's important. And it also helps, by the way, in how you price your customers. If you have a customer that follows rules and they're doing everything you need for them to do, then it's easy to give them a much better rate because they're being efficient with you. And so I think it works both ways. How can I be more efficient? Okay, well, if you help me do this, I'm more efficient, which turns into the fact that I could probably lower my rates because you're helping me help you, correct? So I think that's important.
I love that. What would be one bold prediction that you have for modern leadership in the future?
I really believe that employers need to see their employees more as advisors versus overhead. I've heard that word for so many years. Oh, they're just overhead. This guy's overhead. That guy's overhead. Well, you know, that overhead is getting you to where you want to go. And so I've always been a believer in being an advisor, having them advise me. I walk the floor, I ask questions, and they know their jobs and they're going to tell you what they're thinking. You just have to ask them. And once you ask, then it just comes natural for them. Then next time they see you, they'll come and tell you something. And that's what I think is needed. And I think in the future, if leaders do not take advantage of that and continue to treat folks as just overhead, you know, you have a diverse workforce now more than ever before. Well, take advantage of the diversity that you've hired, walk around, ask them questions, and get them to be engaged in your business. And they will care for you and will care for your business.
I love that. So when we're more looking at our employees, instead of looking at them as overhead or an expense, it's good to look at them as advisors and to have conversations that you had talked about earlier, like collaborative coaching conversations.
Yeah, which I think is important, Nina, because you build trust. Once you start asking people for their opinion, you start to build trust.
Gino, thank you so much. I love what you said about building trust, collaborative conversations. It's definitely what we're all about. And so I just want to thank you so much for getting up and taking the time to meet with us today. All of your opinions are so welcome. And I look forward to hearing what other people have to say about your amazing thought leadership. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nina. Have a wonderful day. And we'll talk soon.